fact that it is on my personal phone because the camera we got doesn't work properly, we will not be able to live stream during July. I apologize for that. I will be starting that up again as soon as I return in August. This week, Wednesday, is the Feast of Saints Peter and Paul, and a celebration of the Holy Eucharist will follow immediately after morning prayer that day. Annie has an announcement.
I was just going to say our next monthly trip to the City Mission is on the 22nd of July. So get in touch with me if you're interested in coming along to that.
Thank you. Thanks to those who helped out on Friday. It was a good crowd, and I understand they had a lot of fun. So, as I mentioned earlier, I will be gone for the month of July. You might have noticed, sitting around two-thirds of the way up the last couple of weeks, incognito, not wearing her clerical collar, was Mother Nancy Kidd. She's the retired rector of St. Matthew's Toledo, and she will be my substitute here during the month of July. She's a good egg, and the fine priest, and you will be in good hands. This is complicated due to some changes with General Convention this summer. My time away became a little bit more complicated. So during the first part of July, I will be taking some actual proper vacation time, and then for the last 2 weeks of August, last 2 weeks of July and the first few days of August, I will be on my high seas chaplaincy adventure with 600 19-year-old cadets on their training voyage. So pray for me and for them. As ever, I'm very grateful to all of you for giving me the opportunity to serve the larger church in that way, particularly some rather homesick kids. Are there any big offerings? Please.
We're tag teaming it today. Still, so I've got my time on board. This coming Thursday, the 30th, Kim turns 2 years older than me.
I just have a couple of announcements. This Wednesday at Riverside Park is a continuation of the Riverside Civic Concert Series, which was restarted. The Finley Civic Concert Band will be in concert at 7 o'clock at the band shell at Riverside Park. It will be each Wednesday, at least for the next several weeks. Next week will be Night Jazz. The week after will be the Finley Civic Concert Band again, and then it'll end up with Pantasia. Also, the Finley Civic Choir is in rehearsals for our August 21st concert. That's going to be at the Marathon Center for Performing Arts. It's a free concert, and so I invite everybody to come out for the concerts. Thank you.
I'm trying to be quiet.
That's why I never
repeat. Good morning. I have a thank offering here today. It is for our great-grandson, Ezra. Ezra will be 5 years old on Wednesday, and he is the holy terror of the great-grandchildren. He likes to fly through the air and leap into things and break a leg.
Yesterday would have been my mother's 100th birthday.
Wow. One final announcement, a particular welcome to those who might be visiting with us for the first time today. Please know that here at Trinity and in the Episcopal Church, all baptized Christians are receive communion, coming forward first for the consecrated bread, the body of Christ, and then, if so desired, a sip of wine from the chalice. If for whatever reason you don't wish to receive communion, you can cross your arms, cross your chest, thusly, to indicate your desire for a blessing rather than the sacrament. In any event, it's the Lord's table, not ours, and you are.
Thank you.
that ye may be made a holy temple acceptable to you. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God.
Christ, according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
When the days drew near for Jesus to be received up, he set his face to go to Jerusalem. And he sent messengers ahead of him, who went and entered a village of the Samaritans to make ready for him. But the people would not receive him, because his face was set for Jerusalem. And when his disciples James and John saw it, they said, Lord, do you want us to bid fire come down from heaven and consume them? But he turned and rebuked them, and they went on to another village. As they were going along the road, a man said to him, I will follow you wherever you go. And Jesus said to him, Foxes have holes, and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. To another he said, Follow me. But he said to him, Lord, let me first go and bury my father. But he said to him, Leave the dead to bury their own dead. But as for you, go and proclaim the kingdom of God. Another said, I will follow you, Lord, but first let me say farewell to those at my home. Jesus said to him, No one who puts his hand to the plow and looks back is fit for the kingdom of God. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Perhaps the most common place
place we see this is when a preacher tackles Jesus' teaching about money, namely his command to give it away, and then turns the whole thing into a purely spiritual exercise, saying something like, well, you don't have to give all your money. Just don't place all your trust in the wealth you have. Be ready to lose it if it comes. Certainly the meaning of Jesus' teaching in that matter is complex, but there's something more to it than how we're supposed to feel about that, right? We're supposed to do something. It's much the same, I think, with regard to Jesus' teaching about family. He's not just saying, be ready to lose your loved ones in the normal course of the day. When they die, or move away, move off to college, say, or whatever, without losing your faith. It's not an entirely spiritual teaching, even if you wish it were, because the spiritual meaning is so much more comfortable than the meaning with any practical implications. But on the other hand, it seems very difficult, if not impossible, to come to terms with an entirely literal reading of the teaching either. Now, there's a chance that Jesus meant exactly what he literally said and that it should be applied to all people for all time. But that would go against the expectation of the rest of Scripture and of the church's interpretation of that Scripture, including Jesus' own words and various other points, which say that commitment to one's family is not only okay, it's actually enjoined on us as a holy obligation. So it seems to me that there's something more complex in Jesus' words than either the simple literal meaning or the entirely spiritualized meaning. Perhaps, and this is just a hunch, albeit a hunch with some theological training and biblical scholarship behind it, that Jesus is warning his interlocutors and all of us, his prospective disciples today, against using our families and other things as excuses. Specifically, I think he may be warning us against making our commitments to family, our appropriate godly enjoying the commitments to family, as an excuse for not doing his work in other realms as well. So let me explain what I'm saying. I'm not saying that there aren't family obligations which affect how we approach our ministries in the church and in the wider world. I'm not saying that missing church on a Sunday from time to time to be with a sick kid or an ailing spouse or parent is going to get us in trouble. I'm not saying that becoming a little less active in some role or another because you've got young children or teenagers or elderly parents or whatever is wrong. I'm not saying that family commitments shouldn't figure into how we discern what God is calling us to do and be, because those are also commitments God gives. Quite to the contrary, family obligations are obligations given to us from God, and fulfilling those obligations is one important way of doing God's work. What I do think we learn from reflection on the gospel is that sometimes misunderstanding the nature of those obligations can keep us from doing that to which we are called. In other words, we can convince ourselves that there's a barrier which doesn't exist between our desire to serve and our ability. I heard the same story over and over again from older classmates of mine in seminary. This is changing nowadays, but a a decade and a half ago when I went through, very few young people went straight to seminary from college or after just a few years' work. I was the only one in my seminary class who came directly from college. And it took some effort, some of you know, to convince my bishop at the time, which was in a different diocese, that I didn't have to go have a career in some other field and enter the ordained ministry in middle age, as had been the ordinary pattern for the previous half century or so. Anyway, many of these classmates of mine had felt called to the priesthood for years, but believed it to be, or else were convinced that it was, absolutely unfeasible, primarily because of their children's need for stability, as they perceived. So many of these, my classmates, waited until all the kids were out of the house and in college, or preferably in their own families, 20 years or more later. And then, when they got to seminary, they realized, gosh, I could have done this earlier. The kids would have been in a good school, and had friends, and they probably would have loved going to seminary with mom and dad, particularly in New York City. Now, of course, this is just one example, and it's not the case in every family situation. But what I'm saying is that we've got to reflect on, rather than dismiss, the possibility of different kinds of ministries we might be called to out. We might find that our family obligations preclude us from, say, volunteering at our monthly trip to the city mission, or serving on vestry or whatever, or we might find that we can fit it in, or better yet, involve the whole family in it. As happened on Friday, where two youngsters were part of the group that helped at the city mission, and I understand it was great, like I said. The point is that individual situations with regard to family, or work, or any other commitment will sometimes close avenues for ministry, but will often open new ones up. It's our responsibility to avoid making excuses and consider how precisely we might be able to follow, what that can look like for each of us in the context of his or her own life. Scale back involvement in one area if you need to. Ramp it up in some other area if you're able. We've just got to do the hard work of thinking about it and praying about it first. If we do that, we might be surprised what we can accomplish for the sake of the gospel. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God,
together in your love and reveal your glory in the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Guide the people of this land and of all the nations in the ways of justice and peace, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give us all a reverence for the earth as your own creation, that we may use its resources rightly in the service of others, and to your honor and glory. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Bless all whose lives are closely linked with ours, and grant that we may serve Christ in them and love one another as he loves us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them the joy of your salvation. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We commend to your mercy all who have died, that your will for them may be fulfilled. And we pray that we may share with all your saints in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I give to you, my own peace I leave with you," regard not our sins with faith of your church, and give to us the peace and unity of that heavenly city, wherewith the Father and the Holy Spirit live and reign, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor.
Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought or word or deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our
only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself, in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. When he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit, to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, "Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen."
God passes all understanding, open our hearts and minds to the knowledge and love of God, and of His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you, and remain with you always.
Amen. Amen.